All right, guys, we're going to go ahead and get started with the next seminar. Once again, thank you guys. I can't tell you guys enough how much we appreciate you guys being here. This is Keith McCormick, John Groser. John's got a great guide service at Okoboji, so if you have questions, make sure you talk to him about that. Keith here is kind of just getting his ears wet, guys. This is his first seminar, so make sure you hassle him and heckle him and give him a hard time. Make sure he's blushing before he's done, because I've been there and John's been there too. So once again, thank you guys. These guys are your talk. I heard really ice strategies and also ice safety, I think, a little bit. So thank you for coming to Clear Lake Bait and Tackle. And
appreciate it.
Yeah.
Great. Hey guys, like you said, early ice strategy. We're going to go through a little bit of safety.
Keith McCormick first, and I'm John Grosvenor.
Okay.
And he'll do a great job. I'm here for moral support, so.
Yeah, he'll fill an hour.
Now, we will have no problem filling an hour, I promise.
Well, you got to have that equipment ready for early ice, so now's the time to start doing that. $8.99, save your life, some ice picks. I've been through 3 times. It's not easy to get in. You can make it a lot easier, but it's you're going to shock you pretty quick.
There's no reason to venture onto the ice without ice picks. I don't care how thick the ice is. There's always bad spots. I mean, close to pressure ridges, the ice can get weak. And, I tell you what, you always have to be prepared because it is ice. Anything can go wrong. I had a DNR guy tell me one time, John, no such thing as safe ice. Right, so you always have to have in the back of your mind that the worst could happen. So be prepared if the worst happens and make sure you've always got your picks.
With these picks, don't put them in your pocket or in your shack or your bucket. A lot of them are made to go together. Put them around your neck, somewhere you can get to them.
Even if you don't have the fancy $7 picks, carry nails, you know, because your fingernails aren't going to be good enough to get you out of the ice. Okay. Use nails if nothing else. Go home today when you get home, and put nails in every single pocket of your ice fishing coat. So you've always got something if you forget your picks.
All right, guys.
You know what you can do?
Yes.
I just went to the hardware store about the dowels. Hammer the nail in and then cut the top end of the nail off.
Great idea.
And then just use a screw eye and a rope.
Anything to get a little traction to get you out. Now, I haven't been through three times, but I know it's cold because I've been in up to here. So
I've been in a couple times. I'm Keith McCormick.
I don't know, and I don't know if you've seen Ice Force 1.
Just make sure you guys hire me first before John.
Yeah.
Just kidding.
Sneak by.
John's a great guy, guys. He does a great job over there. So
I've been in the game for 17 years, so it's been a while. I just got back from 10 days on the English River in Canada, and it snowed all 10 days. So it was cold, but man, did we catch some fish. It was awesome.
Good
heavy spud
bar. I use spud bar all the way to at least a foot of ice. You never know where it might get thin. You do have to go through, you still have it.
General rule of thumb, a good sharp one, I hit the same hole 3 or 4 times. I don't want to see any water.
What's that? Less than that, go for it.
You got to go for
it. Get through.
Usually for early ice, you know, you go into a smaller bay or somewhere out of the way, it's going to be a little bit better ice. So, most of the fish are shallow. Pretty much it.
Yeah. You know, that strategy doesn't always work because the only time I got wet, we went out at 6 o'clock in the morning one time. Some two of my friends and I, and we sent the big guy first. He was 260, and I was littler at the time, and my other friend was way littler than me. And so we sent him out. We sent him out on the ice, and it's like, hey, we're good. And I start tromping right in his footsteps. Bang! Here I am, up to my belly button.
I had the same thing in Okoboji. We followed a Dodge Dually diesel out on the ice, and I had an S10. I fell through.
So you never
three times what I weighed.
But you know, and, you know, he's talking about early ice and spudding your way out. I mean, my philosophy is never be the leader. I mean, you know, I don't care. You know, everybody's got to be the first one out there on the ice. Not me. I follow the leader, and even then, it doesn't make it safe. I mean, you're still responsible for your own set of tracks out there. So spud your way out. You know, every time I take my four-wheeler or my car, I never drive where I haven't drilled. All right? I mean, drill, you know, I'll go 50 feet and drill a hole. Inch my four-wheeler up, 50 feet, drill a hole. Then the next day, I can drive right out to my spot and back, you know?
It's important to know.
Take the time. Take the time to be safe, because you may not get a second chance, you know.
Did you get your S10 out? That's good. Yes. It barely went in?
No, it was in.
You went all the way to the bottom
of the roof, but it was barely over the roof. I have a buddy from West Okoboji.
Yeah, it's expensive.
I wonder what's the cost on the
3 to 5,000, I'd say. That's
I mean, the DNR can get involved, and then you get records.
And, you know, you never want to drive around points or under bridges, you know, because there's always current. I don't care, Okoboji is a lake that, West Okoboji, it's a spring-fed lake. So those currents are different all over the place, and there are currents in there. And it's not a river running through it that creates the currents, it's the springs that create the current. I mean, you could be sitting there and your lure will be way off over here, and then 5 minutes later, it'll be way off over here. So if you're near a point where the water's a little shallower, that water, that current under there, is gonna wear down the ice from underneath. You can't tell that it's bad on top. You're gonna walk on thin ice because it's been undercut. And if, you know, the majority of the people that go through are either around a point, under a bridge. I think Winter Games, we had 7 people go through under a bridge 1 year, in 1 day.
Structures like Rushing Creek has all the trees and all the
heat.
You get that going, yeah.
But I sat and watched a guy one day. I was probably 400 yards away, and he drove right across. He drove onto Little Millers. I don't know if you're familiar with Okoboji, but there's a boat ramp, kind of a makeshift road that just shoots you right down onto the ice. It's not a groomed ramp or paved ramp or anything, but we call it a ramp. And over straight across, you can see it, straight shot where everybody was fishing. Well, there's a long point that goes out under the water between there, and you have to know to go way out around that point. If you're not familiar with the lake, you're gonna drive right over that ice. I sat from 400 yards away and watched the guy go straight across. He saw all those shacks over there, and he goes, "That's where I'm going." And he sunk right in. Fortunately, it was shallow, but I mean, he was in, you know, his cab went down like this, and his rear end was sticking out. He wasn't completely submerged, but his engine was. And called the rescue squad, everything. They came, got him out. It was probably about 2 o'clock in the afternoon, and the rescue people were all leaving. Here comes another guy, right in the same hole, within 10 minutes of them being off the ice. So you've got to know where you're going. You know, don't drive around the lake if you don't know. And if you feel the need to drive around the lake, stay away from points. Stay away from pressure ridges. Now, do you know what a pressure ridge is? Pressure ridge, you know, is where the ice gets heaved up on one side and the ice is being forced down on the other. So if you come up on the side that's being forced down, the weight of this plus your weight could pop that off. I sat next to a pressure ridge one time. I was probably from here to the door, and I was probably a little too close, and I was sitting there with a client fishing, and she was a little spooky on the ice anyway. And that pressure ridge, it broke off while we were sitting there, and our shack came up off the ice about 8 inches. That's how, boom, it blew us up that high. And so it's so important never to drive. You don't even want to walk around pressure ridges. So and just avoid that kind of stuff.
A couple years back in Grosvenor tournament, with the 10,000 gold, kids kind of pressure ridge and it collapsed. And I had a witness letter. I actually They were slid under the ice.
Yeah, and what can happen is when that breaks off, you know, it'll go up like this, and you can go down, and then it covers you up. You have no way out. No way out. You're dead. So stay away from pressure loops.
A good point John made. Know the lake you're going to. I go early mornings when it's dark. So last year I learned a lesson at Elm Lake south of here. I went out on it didn't know anything about it. I went in the dark, got light out, and I was 25 foot from the open square. Wide open water. There's a foot of ice. And I had my quad out there. I didn't. Could drill right in.
Spirit Lake up by us has a lot of springs in it. I mean, on the east side and on the west side, down by Templar. You know, and so there's weak ice year after year after year in those spots. I mean, you don't want to go driving a car over top of those areas. I've seen four-wheelers go in there. It just depends, you know.
It depends on the year. They hold the channel between the Little Lake and Big Lake. It usually seems like the vehicle goes in there once a year. Thank you.
Key thing is to remember, ice is always risky. You want to talk about how to find fish first ice?
Yeah, let's talk about that. Finding fish. I'm big on maps. I don't know if you guys heard Chad yesterday. His map was great that he had. But, I look for contours. First ice, I think, green weeds. And I look for the thickest patch I can find. I don't fish it. That's what I look for. Then I start moving down the hill from it. Don't get fish on that. So, big lakes, don't be intimidated. I usually pick a spot, size up a tennis ball court, and that's what I fish. I might be on 3,000 acres, but I have a tennis court. That's what I drill out and look for. If I don't find it, I make another tennis court. Yes, just go up and down the contour.
My fish looking starts now, and I still got a boat in the water, and I can go out and I can find what looks like could be the weeds that may remain standing. The old saying is that 90% of the fish are in 10% of the water. In the wintertime, it may be 5% of the water, because those fish are going to stick around structure. Weeds, like you just mentioned, green weeds are the important thing. So the fish are going to be around those weeds, but most of the weeds fall. And if they fall flat, there's not going to be anywhere for those fish to hide. They're going to love the ones that are still standing. So I go out the boat now and I look for the weeds that are in the best shape. Now that doesn't mean when the ice forms, I go back out there, it's like, darn it, those weeds are gone. You know, they looked good a month ago and now they're gone. But some of those weeds are still going to be there. And so it's a lot easier to go out in the boat now and locate some spots you want to try than it is once it freezes up and you got to poke holes, you know. He likes to work the side of a tennis court. I'll take a whole shoreline for hundreds of yards and I'll drill, you know, shallow deep, shallow deep, shallow deep, all the way down that shoreline, and I'll pop a camera down. Some guys will actually fish, but I like to pop a camera down. I like to see if the weeds look like it'd be something that would hold fish. And if they're not holding fish now, they may hold fish later in the season, because those fish do migrate throughout the season. And that's another thing I find is, like, if I go out there and I find, oh, there's good weeds, but God, there's not a fish in sight. But you want to file that away, because more than likely there are going to be fish in that spot at some point during the season, more than likely later in the season. But I drill a lot of holes, and you want to look shallow and deep. And by on Okoboji, our weed lines form at about 16 feet. So I'm probably drilling one in at about 8, one in about 14, and you know, just kind of going back and forth and working a very large area. I mean, there's all kinds of strategies. I mean, that no one way is right to look for fish. The key is to find them.
Lures, I mean, it's not heard of a lot. Just Johnson, snare spoon, probably my go-to Panfish. Big enough, it's reflection. Stay above the weeds a ways to get them coming in. It's a dropper chain, that's what I love. Dropper chain for single. They'll come in, they'll mouth it, but they'll suck this in. Bluegills, perch, crappies, they don't limit you. If you do need a finesse down, then like Jason was talking, if you go into a smaller dungeon or some plastics, whatever you gotta do. I like to start off a little bit bigger and flashy.
Another reason I like the Johnson snare spoon, there are other spoons like this with a chain dropper and a hook, which is a great ice fishing bait. I'll pack maggots on there, middle heads, whatever, for perch. But the reason I like this is because in Okoboji we have a little bit deeper water, and this is the heaviest one. I mean, it's very heavy, it's a thicker profile. You got the Shucks jiggers, which I love to use. Everybody's probably used those. These are heavier. They get down faster. So when you've got a school of perch below you that are roaming around, You can get these right down, maybe pick three out versus one, because you're able to get down to them quicker. So the Johnson snare is awesome.